As you should already know, during engineering problem-solving process, we need to deal with quite complicated problems involving many symbols, calculations, and different units. It could be very confusing. Therefore, it is crucially important that we build solid foundation in engineering calculation by understanding the clear relations between quantity, dimension, and unit. Quantities are concepts that are quantifiable. In other words, they can be measured by certain tools and can also be compared. For example, distance is a quantity we are very familiar with. Or we can ask, what is the radius of the circle? In this case, radius is also a quantity. Or simply, what is the length of this desk? Length here is also a quantity. During engineering problem solving, we might use symbols to represent these quantities so we don't have to write the words all the time. And D for distance, R for radius, and L for length are all common symbols. These three concepts are different. But as you may know, they are all measured using the same property, length. And that is the dimension for all of these three quantities. You might notice here, length is both a quantity and a dimension, but distance and radius are not. This is because length is one of the seven base quantities, and it is used to define the dimension length. I will talk more about the base quantities later. Also, to distinguish between these two concepts, as a quantity, the symbol for length is a small case italic L, versus as a dimension, the symbol for length is a capital L. Depending on the measuring tool we use, we will be able to record a value for the quantity that we are interested in. For example, we can use a measuring tape to measure the distance between two poles and get a number of 37. And we use a ruler to measure the radius of a circle we drew and get a number of 4.8. And we can use a yardstick to measure the length of a small desk and get a number of 26.5. Obviously, these numbers alone don't mean much, unless they are given in appropriate units. For the same dimension, as you may know, in this case length, there exist different unit systems and many, many different units. For example, the distance is 37 feet. The radius is 4.8 centimeters, and the length is 26.5 inches. The conversion between the different units for the same dimension is a fundamental skill for engineers, and I will discuss more of that in the following videos. Now let's look at some other examples. For example, another very important quantity is time, normally represented by symbol small case italic t. Since time is also one of the seven base quantities, its dimension is also time, represented by symbol capital T. We can use a stopwatch to measure a time period and get a measurement of, for example, 19 in the unit of seconds. Another quantity we are familiar with is volume, represented by symbol capital italic V. Volume is not a base quantity. Therefore, its dimension is not volume itself. Since volume is the measurement of three-dimensional space, the dimension for volume is length raised to the third power. There are also many common units for volume. For example, cubic meter, liter, milliliter, gallon, or even cup. A soda can has a volume of about 355 milliliters. Another physical quantity is velocity. which could be simply defined as the distance traveled over a certain time. In other words, distance divided by time. Therefore, its dimension is length L over time T. Or in exponential notation as L to the first power, which doesn't need to be written out explicitly, multiplied by T to the negative first power. The velocity of a car at this moment could be 45 in the unit of miles per hour. As you can see, the dimensions of both volume and velocity are derived from base dimensions length and time. According to the International System of Units, or the SI unit system, there are only 7 base quantities and therefore 7 base dimensions, and we already mentioned the two, length and the time, and the dimensions for all the other quantities can be derived from these 7 base dimensions. So let's look at them now. Listed here in this table are the 7 base quantities and their associated base dimensions, as well as the base units, according to the most widely used, most authoritative system of measurement in the world, the International System of Units, also known as the SI unit system. Please pay special attention to the different symbols given in this table, written in red. We already mentioned length. As a base quantity, its symbol is a small case, italic L. As a dimension, its symbol is capital L, and its SI base unit is meter. Then we have the base quantity mass. As a dimension, its symbol is capital M, and its SI base unit is kilogram. Many people would think that the base unit for mass is gram. It's not. It should be kilogram. We also already mentioned base quantity time. As a dimension, its symbol is capital T, and its SI base unit is a second. Then we have the quantity electric current. The symbol for the dimension of current is capital I, and the SI base unit is ampere. The next base quantity is temperature. The symbol for the dimension temperature is a capital Greek letter theta, and the SI base unit is Kelvin. The next base quantity is the amount of substance. The symbol for the dimension is capital N, and its SI base unit is mole. The last one is luminous intensity. The symbol for the dimension is capital J, and its SI base unit is candela. So now we have the 7 base dimensions. As I mentioned before, for any other quantity, for example, for quantity Q, its dimension is derived from these 7 base dimensions in the following form, which is simply the product of the 7 dimensions, each raised to a certain power. These exponents, alpha, beta, gamma, etc., are simply the first 7 letters in the Greek alphabet, and they are usually small integers, such as negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, etc. And of course, if the exponent is a 0, then this base dimension does not have to appear in the derived dimension. Now let's look at some examples. For example, for physical quantity acceleration, we know that the definition of acceleration is the time derivative of velocity. Therefore, the dimension of acceleration is L length times T time to the negative first power, this is the dimension of a velocity, divided by T time, which is the dimension of time. And when we combine these together, we get the dimension for acceleration, which is L length times T time to the negative second power. For the physical quantity force, which is defined through Newton's second law to be m mass multiplied by a acceleration. To find the dimension for the force, it is m, the dimension for mass, multiplied by L times T to the negative second power, which is the dimension for acceleration that we just worked on. Therefore, after we combine these together, the dimension for the force is L, the length, m mass times T time to the negative second power. Sometimes, different quantities can have the same dimension. For example, for the physical quantity, moment of a force, it is defined in a simplified way as force multiplied by d, the moment arm. Therefore, the dimension of the moment can be determined as the dimension of the force, which is lmt to the negative second power, multiplied by the dimension of the moment arm, which is the length l. Therefore, when we combine these, the dimension of the moment is l to the second power mt to the negative second power. But if we look at a different physical quantity, work of a force, which can be defined in a simplified way as force times l, l being the displacement along the line of action of the force. Therefore, the dimension of work, as we work it out, is also l to the second power mt to the negative second power. Although the dimensions are the same, the meanings of these two quantities are not. It is also not unusual for a quantity to be dimensionless. For example, in fluid mechanics, Reynolds number is calculated to predict if the flow is laminar or turbulent. For fluids flowing in the pipe, Reynolds number is calculated by this equation. In this equation, rho here is the density of the fluid and its dimension is L length to the negative third power times m mass. V is the mean velocity of the fluid, and we know that the dimension for velocity is length over time. D here is the inner diameter of the pipe, and its dimension is simply L length. And lastly, mu here is the dynamic viscosity of the fluid, and its dimension is length to the negative first power times mass times t, the time to the negative first power. Therefore, when we write the dimension equation to determine the dimension of Reynolds number, we realize that all terms get canceled out. Therefore, it simply equals to 1. So Reynolds number is a dimensionless quantity, and we can say that its dimension is a pure number 1. During engineering calculation, there is a basic rule of dimensional homogeneity, which states that all terms on both sides of the equation that are connected, either by plus signs or minus signs, must have the same dimension. Actually, they should have the same units as well, but that can be achieved through unit conversion and will not pose a fundamental issue. For example, here we have a basic principle in physics, the principle of work and energy. The term on the left-hand side is total work done to the system, and we know that the dimension of work is the dimension of force times length, which is length squared times mass times time to the negative second power. On the right-hand side, we have the difference in kinetic energy of the system. And as you can see, kinetic energy is defined as 1/2 times mass times velocity squared. Therefore, the dimension for energy is mass times the dimension of velocity, which is length over time raised to the second power. And that is also length squared times mass times time to the negative second power. Therefore, as you can see, all terms in this equation that are connected by plus sign or minus sign on both sides of the equation all have the same dimension. Therefore, this equation demonstrates dimensional homogeneity. We can apply the rule of dimensional homogeneity during our analysis, and that is called the dimensional analysis. For example, here we have another fundamental physics law, Newton's law of gravitation, which states that the attractive gravitational force between two objects with masses m1 and m2 respectively, separated by a distance of r, is determined by this equation. Here, g is the universal constant of gravitation, and let's apply the dimensional analysis to determine its dimension. Since on the left-hand side we have the force, and we are already very familiar with the dimension of force, and because of dimensional homogeneity, the entire right-hand side group must also have the dimension of the force. Therefore, we can set up our dimensional equation, which includes the dimension of g times mass raised to the second power over the dimension of distance, which is length to the second power. And from this equation, we can easily solve for the dimension of g to be length to the third power times mass to the negative first power times time to the negative second power. In fact, the universal constant of gravitation, g, equals to 66.73 times 10 to the negative 12th power in the unit of meter, which is length to the third power, divided by kilogram, the unit for mass, and second, the unit for time raised to the second power. As you can see, it is a very small quantity, and that is the reason why normally we do not feel the gravitational force between objects, except for the gravitational force exerted by the Earth due to its enormous mass.